Dobroveče svima. Hvala što ste došli i ovo veče. Ovaj isečak čitanja polifonijskog teksta bio je u stvari isečak iz knjige Alena Badjua, na kojoj je radio gotovo jednu deceniju, njegove remake-a kao književnog žara i prevodilačkog Platonove države. Ovo je bio isečak o mitu o pećini. Kasnije ćemo se vratiti na samu temu ovog dela. Hteli bismo samo da kažemo da večeras kao sinoć nećemo imati iste tehničke mogućnosti, nemamo simultano prevođenje, ali pošto polazimo od toga da je komunistička hipoteza uvek internacionalna, poliglotska, mi vas molimo za prava na malo zapravo našeg internog preskakanja na jedan ili drugi jezik, tako da je zamišljeno je da zapravo Alen se lepo našalio da je engleski jezik zapravo taj koji smo izabrali, ali kao internacionalni, iako bi naravno, ali smo mu rekli da je srpsko-hrvatski naravno ovde večeras jako prisutan, tako da krećemo od ovog trenutka, kolega Karamanić je na engleskom probati uz momente kada naša prijateljica Ivana Maksić će probati da nam, koja je vodila današnji program Klemperer, ona će prevoditi i molimo vas za malo strpljenja i prava na grešku, pošto nemamo iste tehničke, kao što sam rekla, mogućnosti kao sinoć.
So, good evening. Just to make a short summary, from yesterday night we got one special opportunity to listen one sort of substance of the philosophy of Alain Badiou, a text which is sort of exclusively presented here in Belgrade, and which condenses incredible complexity of this philosophy, but at the same time in a very simple way. There are two, I would say, generally important orienting points of philosophy of Alain Badiou, and they create a sort of dialectical matrix. And one point, it is about the point of starting from a very, very abstract way of thinking, of course, the abstract beginning, starting from the idea. The idea which is at the same time political idea and unconditional demand for equality. One would say an idealist, a transcendental, transhistorical moment of this philosophy. On the other side, and this other side, this other point is, of course, organically connected with this one, with the first one, and this is the point of the historical references. Namely, the idea always arises in the concrete situation, and here I would say that Badiou is a sort of a strict Hegelian, if I can say, because the idea always appears as a concrete universal. It's in that sense, there is no point of accusing Badiou of idealism, because idea is always connected with the subject, which is one material reality, connected with its own situation and its own localization, with its own time and space. And this is of decisive importance for Badiou's philosophy, because we have very strictly, very, how I would say, selected points, historical points, where what he calls the idea of communism, of affirmation, of unconditional equality has appeared in the history. This is, for example, Spartacus rebellion, uprising, then French Revolution, October Revolution, 68 in France and worldwide, cultural revolution in China, and so on. Tonight, we have seen one of these points connected with the 68 in the film of Godard. The film was made in the 67, in the eve of the so-called Red May of 68, which is, Godard himself has built a specific friendship to Godard as a director and intellectual and political activist. And on the other side, of course, this is this historical reference to the 68. So, to continue in a mood or in the mode of presenting from the yesterday, where we actually tried to demonstrate how Badiou's philosophy is productive in the sense that it can go in the numerous directions in a way that we problematized the very abstract philosophical notions, terms, and how they function with each other within the conceptual field, but also open some political questions, ending in a way in a very daily politics of the some recent events, which we all know that happened in Paris. This, I think, demonstrates as well incredible productivity of one philosophical system, as much as it is close, but it produces incredible infinity, like good in the sense of good infinity of thinking different fields. So tonight we have with us two film theoreticians and critiques. This is Miroljub Stojanović and Ivan Belisavljević. Yeah?
And now Ozren has a question first.
Yes, Ivan Omčilović is with us. We have a help of a translator in the case, because part of...
No, she's a poet, and she's he's like a friend helping us to translate.
And
Ozren Pupovac.
Here's our comrade Ozren Pupovac from Istanbul.
And from so many other places. So
I would first give the floor to Ozren, who will have something to ask. Yeah.
To ask Alan,
So a question which follows immediately from the viewing of the film and from something that Slobodan just mentioned. What is interesting about Godard's La Chinoise is that on the one hand, it is a film of anticipation. It is a film filmed in 1967, but of course it anticipates everything which happens a year afterwards, namely in May 1968. But it is also a film which in a certain sense points to the incredible productivity of philosophy in this period. Because in fact, it is one of the rare films in which a philosophical thesis as such are cited in a political context, in an explicitly political context. The film, in fact, cites a couple of theses from Louis Althusser. So, as a certain opening question, I wanted to ask Alain Badiou, what was his personal relationship, to tell us a little bit about his personal relationship and his personal engagement in this context, in the context of 1968, and specifically of the ways in which he sees the importance of the specific fusion between abstract philosophical work, between abstract philosophical thoughts and concrete political action.
In fact, May 68 has been, for me, a complete subjective transformation. It was not only something like a new political situation or something like a local experience. It was much more. It was something like, for me, an event in the strong sense of the word. And I think the effect of May 68 on me, and after that on my philosophical work, was at four different levels. First, the very notion of an event, simply. That is the possibility that something happens which creates for you the possibility of a sort of new birth, like a subjective becoming, which is really like the birth of a new subjective world. And so in my abstract philosophy, the concept of event is essential, but in some sense, it's a result of May 68 for me. The first point. The second point is concerning politics, the discovery of two things. First, that the French Communist Party was not at all a revolutionary party. Because the French Communist Party not only has been in some sense indifferent to the event, but largely against the event. And it was, for me, the definitive proof that French Communist Party was something like an institution, something like a part of the political life of France, but without any real desire to transform completely the situation. So it's a negative point, but very important, because if you think in the 60s that the French Communist Party is not really something like the promise of the new future, you must have the idea that it's a necessity to begin something else. So to create a new form of existence of the communist idea. And so it's a second point, the conviction that we enter the world, and not only me, in a new sequence of the history of politics, that the classical communist sequence is closed, in fact. It was my conviction before, many years before the end of Soviet Union and so on. It was really the experience of 68, which was the first proof of the end of the sequence, which can name the Leninist sequence. The third point is a discovery really important too, that is the possibility of a direct relationship between intellectual and workers. It was a point of the French Communist Party to organize the relationship between struggle class in factories and so on one side, and the existence of communist intellectuals on the other side, only by the mediation of the party. It was strictly forbidden to have direct relationship between intellectuals and workers. And what I have experimented in May 68 was the possibility of something like that. A big part of my activity during May 68 was precisely to discuss with young workers in factories, to organize new reunions between intellectuals and workers, and to experiment that it was perfectly possible. And so this possibility was a transform of in impossibility, finally, by the complicity of French Communist Party with the general framework of the society. And the last point, which is of philosophical nature, much more, is that in politics, like probably in all other forms of truth, that is the work of art, the scientific discovery, and the true love, probably the virtue is to say, I continue, that is a sort of patience, not to be impatient, not to want immediate results. And I name all that faithfulness. To be faithful to the event is to create not only a moment like May 68, but a new time. After May 68, the idea was to create a new political time. But it was a more general question. And it is the origin of my philosophical conviction that a truth is in fact a process and not a judgment. A process may be a long process, maybe a process of many centuries. And so it's also the promise of immortality in some sense. Immortality because you are the subject of something which maybe has a very long existence, and you are a part of this long existence, and as Spinoza has written, we experiment that we are eternal. And maybe it's my last word concerning May 68. It has been the first time for me to experiment that I am eternal.
Thank you very much. Just a short comment, if I can. This point of, as you said, the truth is the process, and actually this process is the a point of many centuries, actually reminds on Althusser's let's say warning that, for example, in order bourgeoisie to constitute itself, it took actually 600 years of painful and diligent work since the times of Hobbes through Locke, Rousseau, and so. Can you just shortly comment? Do you think that there is a certain class position?
I think that the question of creation of a new time is not directly in dependency of the sequence. It's a general affirmation. So it had been true also for bourgeois revolution. In fact, the Enlightenment, Rousseau, Voltaire, and so on, was also at the beginning of something which, after them, are a long new time. In some sense, finally, the liberal time. And we are always in the liberal time. Mm-hmm. And so, Rousseau was, Voltaire was really eternal in that sense. But now our work is different. We must open a new sequence. And May 68 was also the beginning of a beginning. Not at all the beginning of a revolution immediate, and not at all, because from the 80s of the next century, we are not at all in revolution, but in pure reaction, liberal reaction, precisely. So it was the creation of a new possibility of what? Finally, my interpretation is possibility of a new communism, or if you want, the creation of the possibility of the third stage of the history of communism, 19th century, the invention of the very notion of communism, the next century, attempt to realize communism in the form of different states, socialist states. But it has been a failure, probably a failure because there is contradiction in some sense between communism and state. Precisely, because communism is also the promise of the end of the state power. So all that is, in some sense, finished, and we are in the opening of the third stage of communism, neither a strict beginning, nor the realization of communism by the construction of a new power, of a new state power. And May 68 was, in some sense, a promise of this new beginning, or the beginning of the possibility of the beginning. Mm-hmm. And you are now in, maybe, I hope, something like the true beginning of the beginning. Mm-hmm. But the end, it's another question.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Now, after this brief interrelation between biography and philosophy in politics, let us give the voice to the
Antonio Labriola je jednom rekao da iz knjiga računa fiorentinskih trgovaca gotovo ništa nećemo saznati o duhu Danteove božanstvene komedije. Mislim da je to sjajan uvod u generalni problem sa Godarovim opusom. Naime, ovdje imamo identičnu situaciju. Iz Godarovih revolucionarnih filmova ne saznajemo nikad ništa o revolucijama koje ti filmovi prikazuju. Moje pitanje, da li ovu tezu smatrate održivom i molio bih za komentar.
So is there a real connection? He believes there is no real connection, or let's say the perception of revolution that we can see in Godard's films and the revolution itself. So,
but the quotation is very important.
But the most important, according to Antonio Abriola, we still can't find the spirit of Dante, Divine Comedy, from the Count of Florence Merchants, you know. For me, it's a situation exactly the same with Godard film world, because we have revolutionary movies, but we don't have any pictures of these true revolutions in these movies. Is it acceptable for you as a thesis?
You know, I think that Godard, in my vision, has never been really an activist. It's not at all really a political thinker or even a political artist. Godard is much more something like an artist, certainly, the conviction of Godard being that the art must be a witness of its time. And to be a witness of the time, of the present, a witness of the present, is a condition for the artistic determination of Godard. And so in La Chinoise, there is no clear engagement of Godard, in fact. There is something like an ironic witness of something which is for him important, certainly, which is new, which is the promise of a new possibility, but which also is, at the very beginning, is a failure. That is, what we have in the film is precisely the point where what is possible and what is impossible are practically the same thing. And the conviction of all these young students are absolute conviction in some sense, but in another sense, something very weak, which is not the real construction of a political world, but which seems to be much more something like a new form of collective life of the small group of students, new relationship, new forms of love, and also a new dogmatic language. And this new dogmatic language becomes a sort of code of the relationship between them.
You mean in the area of filmmaking or ideological new language?
Yes, I think that the ideological level is not in direct relationship with political practices. For example, there is no concrete relationship with others. There is something closed in the group, really. It's a sort of revolution in a room. And even when we are the sequence of terrorism, it's very difficult to decide in the movie itself if it's a real or it's a sort of dream, something which is, it's a film like a dream in some sense. And so it's very interesting to see how a movie can propose a real, something like a real witnesses concerning the sequence, and without any real engagement other than the artistic engagement, finally. And it is why we learn something of the ideological existence of young students in the end of the 60s, I agree with you, without any clear relationship with political and history as such. And in some sense, Godard is a pure artist. And
but what is the true demarcation line between these two things? What is the true demarcation line between these two things?
I don't, it's unclear, finally. Okay. It's really unclear.
Ivan Velisavljevic.
Now have to talk behind the back of this small Maoist group, like Godard with his characters. Actually, it's a great introduction for my question, because there's also something new when we see this film today. There was something new. So if Godard didn't historicize, we should today, and we can. There's an interesting sentence by Pauline Kael, who wrote a review about this film. She says, this film is like a speed freak's anticipatory vision of the political horrors to come. And what is Godard doing? He's a speed freak in terms of form. So it was a part of the new wave. And what was new at that time, I think that's what interests me to hear your comment on. For example, we see a bunch of words, verbals, inside the movie. They shout Mao's sentences. The words are all over, and they go really fast. then there's this distracting neo-Brechtian devices, signs and songs and jump cuts and stuff. And there's also novelistic digressions. The story goes at certain points and then comes back in this apartment and so on. And at that time, Jean-Louis Comolli wrote an article saying that for him, the central question of La Chinoise is, should we in the cinema believe what we see? And we see, Jacques Bontemps wrote that Godard is arousing himself in fight in the places where the enemy claimed the world is at peace. And that was the film form. So the enemy, the classical film, said everything is all right with the film form. And then Godard says, no, that's the enemy's position. We should fight inside a film form. So what we see in this film is that this Maoist group claims, Guillaume claims, one of the main characters, that politics is theater. And they sort of show that politics is performance, the exercise on the balcony, and it's funny to see it today. It's a semi-satirical film of them. But I think what Godard shows us is that politics is self-reflexive cinema. So that's, I think, the historical heritage of this political modernism, politicizing the form. If the film is self-reflexive, if it shows the devices, then it's politics. Then it's the new leftist sort of. What do you think that is left today of all this stuff? Because that Brian Henderson had at that time a text saying towards a non-bourgeois camera style. Like Bazin said that movies show a complex and mysterious and deep film, and it should be shown by in-depth staging, like really three-dimensional images. And then Brian Henderson says, no, Godard shows a flat. You know, these guys are in a flat, in an apartment, and the images are flat. So no bourgeois, mysterious, and complex world. But do you think that today there's something left out of this notion? Can we proclaim that as a general rule? Like, does every in-depth staging in film is bourgeois? Or does flat images and neo-Brechtian devices and breaking the illusion in film is really a revolutionary filmmaking?
No, I think that the hand of the movie is a pessimistic vision, certainly. It's the vision of a strict closure. The house of the bourgeois house of it's also the idea of the beginning of the summer, holidays and so on. And so it's a return to ordinary life, in some sense, the end of the movie. In the image of something which is closed. Absolutely. And so, finally, I agree with you. The most revolutionary intention or result of Godard is to find against the its proper idea of what is the classical forms of in cinema. The entire film is constructed around quotations in the text. Quotations of Althusser, quotations of Mao, quotations of some tract, a quotation of declaration of the Maoist organization UJCML and so on. And also, Also, I can take a quotation of me. One important quotation of a text of me which has been published in a Cahier Marxist-Leninist, so it was in the context of the movie. And this organization of the text around quotations is also a form of distance between Godard and the material of the movie. Because it's not a personal engagement, a personal organization, but between the new forms of the movie and the contents of the life of young revolutionary in 1967, we have precisely a sort of cold universe of quotations which create a distanciation in in the Brechtian sense of the word, between Godard, the artistic presentation of all that, and what is presented in the movie. And so it's a very strong film concerning this years, 1966, 1967, which are the beginning of the beginning of the beginning, in some sense. And it's a strong picture because precisely there is a form of distance which is not a form of critics or of negation, but which is a form of truth in some sense, a truth which is a sort of objective and cold truth in one sense, and in another sense, something which is absolutely magnificent and beautiful in the invention of forms. And so is the result as an artistic testimony, really accomplished in my vision of this sequence, which is I was 20 years old at this moment, and it was really my youth, and so I recognize the situation. I can say that. And I was engaged myself in the situation, but I recognize the artistic distance, which is like the eternization of this moment, very singular, very particular. In some sense, all these young men are completely mad. But it was a magnificent madness.
In true Maoism, there are only four main points, and maybe it's better to say four question marks. It's very important for all Godard revolutionary works. The first one is, who's talking in the work? The second one is, from where? The third one is, for whom? And the fourth and the last one is, in the name of what idea? Be so kind, please, and let me know about Godard's relationship with these four points of true Maoism.
You know, in some sense, the Maoism, which is in the film, is a French creation. The French creation in the precise sense. I have said to you that the discovery of all the 60s, but with the most important point in 68, but the beginning was before, was that we cannot have any hope of revolution on the side of the French Communist Party. And so it was also the end of the paradigmatic Soviet Union and so on. And so it was also the dream of a completely different form of communism, even in the form of a new state. And Maoism has been, during the 60s, the progressive conviction that in China, under the direction of Mao, we have a new form of communism, because with the Cultural Revolution beginning in 1962, donc just before, we have a new dialectics between the state, the party, and the masses. We have the acceptation by the power of a very strong and big revolt of students first, and after that of workers in factories. And so the idea was that we can have a new communism as a politics if you accept that the question of politics cannot be reduced to the question of the state power, but must be also the question of revolution, of new revolution, include some forms of revolutions inside the socialist state. After all, the name Cultural Revolution was the idea that inside a socialist country with a classical socialist state and the power of the party and so on, it's a necessity to have new forms of revolution. And it was the point of departure of the French Maoism. And even if in 1967, Godard is probably skeptic concerning all that, a sort of skeptical friendship for all that, it's true that after 68, Godard had been engaged, really, during, not forever, but during some years, and engaged in this idea, really, of a new possible form of class struggle, revolution, and so on, and finally, new form of communism. So, La Chinoise is probably the first movement of Godard in this direction, which is not a conviction in the movie, but prepares the possibility of the conviction. But the conviction has been created in him, not by the invention of the French Maoism, but by 68 and the consequences of 68.
I would like to talk a little bit more about who's talking in this film. That's very interesting for me when I see it again for the fifth or sixth time. This little group, these French Maoists, as you said, the French invention of Maoism, is actually it starts as a bourgeois position. The parents of Veronique are bankers. The people who lend them the apartment own factories. So inside this small bourgeois apartment, they start to create their Maoism, the French version of Maoism. And there's an interesting scene when Guillaume talks how politics is theater, when he bandages himself. Then this bandage comes down to his neck, and it looks like a typical middle-class French scarf. So when you look at the details of this film, you can see this juxtaposition of class position and revolutionary theory inside of this small group. And Guillaume is an actor. And at one point, you hear Veronique saying that this Marxism-Leninism was his version. He was very, very boring with that thing. But then, and you only see men given lessons in this film, political lessons. And females do not. At half of the movie, you don't see them giving any lessons. And then I think that Veronique, this girl, commits an act of an ontological decision, so to say, in your terms. She decides to commit a crime. She decides to take an act of terrorism. And it becomes, the film becomes her story, actually. For me, when I see it again, the film ends with her words, and she's the one that that takes over this Guillaume's story of Marxism, Leninism, and Maoism, and she makes the first decision. And she talks how she's been cut off of the workers, and she wants to pick up the peaches, and that's why she believes in cultural revolution. We should close their universities and go to the countryside and live with the people and get to know workers. And she has an interesting conversation in the train between Francis Gerson, and she said, where he says, "That's not the road. You don't know what you stand for." So at the end, I believe that by taking over this story, Veronique becomes a very important figure. And at that time, she was married to Godard. Anne Wiazemski, the actress, was married to Godard. So she was taking over the Godard's film at the same time. So I would like to ask you, what do you think about this whole connection between taking over this bourgeois Maoist middle class story of communism and making an ontological decision towards violence, because that's what happened to the European left. After 10 years, we had terrorist groups, we had left-wing terrorism, and I think it sort of ended just like Francis Janson said in the film. It was left by just a few members cut off of the big masses and the support that they had.
First, concerning the bourgeois context of the movie of Godard, it's first something largely true. I have made myself many reunions in very splendid apart. But it's not the point, because the point is that all new forms of politics begins in some sense in intellectual middle. And in this case, it was students of Nanterre, of the faculty of Nanterre, it's very precise. And in fact, the beginning of 68 was really a revolt of the students in the University of Nanterre. So it was a precise point which is divided. On one part, effectively, there is something which is inside the bourgeois world. But in another sense, is something which is inside the intellectual world. It's not the same thing. After all, Marx and Engels and Lenin and Mao and many others are all intellectuals. So the level of the theoretical beginning of the process of communism is always the mobilization of a part of the intellectual world around some ideas. And it's true also that after 68, we have, during a long time, a real process of unity between some group of intellectuals and a significant part of workers and strangers, workers coming from Africa, and so on and so on. On one part. Concerning the end of the movie, it's a fable, because before 68 does not exist in France any form of terrorism. So it's really a fable. It's a sort of anticipation of Godard, which is a part of his pessimistic appreciation, finally. Finally, if you want to do really something, and if you are strictly in the world of intellectual and ideas, maybe terrorism, the crime, is the proof that you can act, you can do something. But it was a fable, it was not true. And the true way has been finally much more the idea to go with the workers, to go with the poor peasants, and so on, during many years sometimes. And so I think that the fable of violence, terrorism, and so on is a part of the idea of Godard, that all that may be is only a very short sequence of the life of students, and all that finally be closed. Closed in two possible significations. First, closed in the bourgeois apartment during the summer, but also closed in the form of the crime, which is, by necessity, without any real signification. But I insist on the point that after 68, the vision of Godard and the film of Godard are very different. And so I insist on the fact that you are the invention, the intellectual invention of French Maoism in the end of the 60s, and you are after 68, something very different, which is the search for new forms of politics. And 68 is very important because it is a passage from the first form to the second.
I think that Azran has now a question. Then it's for you.
So to continue on this question of the new form of politics, which is sought, and to return to your fourth point concerning May 68, namely the idea that it is important to have patience and to continue. Another term or another metaphor which is usually connected to that is the idea of confidence. One needs to have confidence into something or concerning something which cannot be proven. And this is a certain, again, specificity of French Maoism, because it was the translation of Mao's own dictum that one needs to have confidence in the masses. In this sense, this is also a certain break with Marxism as such, because there is no idea anymore of a guarantee in terms of the analysis of society that there is a revolutionary class as such, or that there is a certain vanguard or a certain most advanced part of society, which as such provides already the guarantee of a potential revolution. So in this, and this idea of abandoning the relationship between politics and society was central to your philosophical development. How do you see today the articulation of the idea of a confidence concerning something which cannot be proven?
Certainly today I have no proof at all. And so it's confidence as such. But you know, the first revolutionary attempts in the 19th century with workers and so on are in 1830, something like that. And the first victorious revolution is in 1917. So something like one century. Okay. One century, why not? And during all this century, we find long sequences of pure capitalism, imperialism, colonialism. We can say that at the end of the 19th century, the power of the imperialist bourgeoisie is practically the unique form of existence of politics in Europe. So certainly the question of confidence too is also the same as the question of historical patience. We cannot have hope that the result is visible always. Very often, the political work is a work without clear visibility of the goal. And we must accept this situation, especially when we know that we are at the beginning of a sequence, that the old form of communism, which are the communism of the socialist state, is really finished. So when we begin, we know that it's not the end. And so we are between the two, and it's always a very hard sequence, a difficult sequence, but it's a necessity that some of us accept this sequence and accept to keep the promise of the future.
And my last question for today is my favorite joke on Godard's professional life. of all his unpleasant questions for him, one of these questions is, which is the most horrible moment in your professional life, in your career as a film director? Sorry.
Okay. Yeah. Could you continue?
Yeah. What did he say?
Could you continue?
Okay. And he said, the most horrible moment in all my professional life is after the success.
Okay, could we just continue? I mean, continue, it's a polyphone. I mean, that's a world.
Okay.
Classical trouble.
After the great success of his movie La Vie, I went to Geneva University and I saw at the wall of university the next sentence, down with Godard, the most stupid of all French friends of China. Please let me know, is it some kind of ideological opportunism or something similar? Did you understand my question?
Could you repeat, because it was a polyphonic.
Okay, the joke. According to Godard, the most horrible moment is in his professional life was in Geneva University after the great success of his movie La Vie. That movie was enormous commercial success in France, in the rest of Europe. And he went over there and saw at the wall the next graffiti, the next sentence, down with Godard, the most stupid of all French friends of China. Mm-hmm. And according to Godard, it is the most painful event in his life. What do you think about, to be honest, is it some kind of opportunism or something similar?
Godard's
opportunism. Of course, Godard's opportunism.
Godard's opportunism. Is it some kind
of... To consider this as the most horrible event.
Yeah, to consider that as
You know, I cannot use directly the word opportunism concerning Godard. But I accept to say that Godard has always been in the idea, it was my first idea this evening, that Godard is not engaged really at a political level. It's a artistical witness of the sequence. And when the sequence changes, Godard changes too with the sequence. And from a political point of view, it's opportunism. But from artistical point of view, and if you represent the cinema as the artistical witness of the present, it's not really opportunism. It's the form of the creation of Godard, which is to find new forms which are appropriate to witness the present. And so I, as I often do, I excuse the artists. if the result is impressive, I excuse the artist. What I do not excuse is the political opportunism. It's something different. Something different because I cannot confuse really political activity and political practices and artistical practices. There is crossing, there is relationship, there is no complete indifference, but it's not the same thing, finally. Just the same thing. To create something like a new form of organization with workers coming from Africa, I know what it is. It's not the same thing that to realize a movie, really.
We have just one very short question. We know that the theater is very that you are very faithful to the position that the theater is one of the, you're connected to the theater as a figure of the one of procedure of the truth. We will know more tomorrow in Novi Sad. We will have a special meeting with the public on this topic. But I would like to propose you to comment one text of Jacques Rancière, which is La Chinoise, of Godard in his book La Fable Cinématographique, who says something for me very, very close to what you also are often meditating about, this relation between politics and theatrality, despite that you didn't point that tonight. But Rancière said something like, in his really very precious essay, that it's there is something like a permanent figure of theater in every real political event. And I found the same in your thoughts about the big events, about this sudden theatrality when, for example, during one occupation of the factory, there is this kind of relation between one and the mass. And maybe you could follow this just to comment, surely, this relation between theatrality and the politic of emancipation. Occupation of the places, of the factories.
It's probably the birth of a new form of politics to occupy. Yeah. Occupy Wall Street. Yeah. And it's the beginning in France is at the moment of the big strike of 1936, the invention really of the gesture to occupy the factories. But the transformation of occupation has its beginning in 68, really, because the occupation of factories was not only a new mean for the strike, but also a new place for possible politics, a new place for collective discussions, not only between the workers, but between the workers and many other people. And so probably today we have new forms of that, occupation of big places in towns, occupation of some symbolic places and so on. And I think that this new necessity to occupy a place, a space, is also a new mean to find new forms of collective discussion and collective decision. So it's not only a new mean to fight, to organize the struggle and so on, but it's the beginning of the new forms of organization. And you know, the question of organization is the most difficult question in politics. It's a very difficult question. And during practically all the 19th century, we have had failure and bloody failure of insurrections, of struggle, because organization was too weak. And it is why the Leninist idea to create organization on another paradigm with centralization, discipline, and in some sense, a military form, has been a success during a long time because it has been victorious. And you know, in the question of revolution, the question of victory is a very important question. We cannot repeat for eternity the failure and the defeats. And so when you have a concrete victory, there is something like a collective enthusiasm for this victory. It has been the case for the Bolshevik Revolution in the 1917. And during many, many, many years, there have been millions of people who have confidence to the result of the Bolshevik Revolution because it has been a victorious revolution. In some sense, the first victorious revolution. And all that is finished now, okay? But we must find the new forms of victory, after all. We are not in the idea to organize only Blue Day defeats. And so there is a collective work to find the new way of possible victory, first at the local level, but after that at a more important level. And I think that occupation, to occupy, is a moment of this invention of new forms of organization, of discussion, of a collective movement, which is unclear for the moment, but it's not a problem. What is clear one day begins to be unclear. It's a law of knowledge and of political knowledge, too. So it's really my position about this point, to occupy, which has been a very important fact during 68, which is an important fact today in Egypt, like in Wall Street and in other places, is the search for the new form of organization, which is not probably the Leninist organization, because the failure of all the socialist state is also the failure of the Leninist form of the Communist Party. And it had been some reforms of this paradigm, even here in Yugoslavia. There had been a rupture with the Stalinist paradigm, after all. It's a part of this invention. But we must continue, and we must find one day the new possibility to be victorious against the globalized capitalism, which is the dominant form today of social organization in the world. And so I insist on the point, to occupy is also something like an intellectual search, and not only a practical mean to do politics.
Okay.